Second. Okay, go.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome everybody on this hot Monday, Sunday morning. If any of you are new to RUC, please make yourself known to somebody. In the meantime, enjoy. Thank you for coming. Mac is going to be doing our sermon today. We're not going to do any announcements because Mac also does a very fantastic job at our email list. So if you'd like to receive any announcements and you're not already signed up, please email the office and we'll have your email so you get the news of what's happening in and around RUC. So this morning we're going to do a gathering song. I don't know if Nancy's helping or not. Okay, so we're doing the Let Us Build a House.
The words are right on the thing.
Just the short
version of Let Us Build a House.
There is only a short
version. That's the one we'll do then.
Yeah. No, but in the book there's like 8 verses.
Oh, no.
Nah.
Yeah. No.
So stand if you're able. Sit in spot.
Get closer to the mic.
Welcome to our inclusive, open spiritual community.
We hold as sacred the oneness of all people and all creation. We hold as sacred that there are many pathways to God. Christianity is one of them. The teachings of Jesus inspire us to love ourselves and others more greatly, without shame or blame. We hold as sacred the power of community and prayer. We hold as sacred that love comes in any forms and support anyone who is finding their own way to live out love in the world. We hold as sacred that we are loved, we matter, we are part of God's plan.
Okay, so good morning everybody. If you're not familiar with this, we're doing passing of the peace, where I will say the peace of God be with you, and then you also say the peace end with you. And then turn to your neighbors and say hi, wave, shake hands if you'd like. So good morning everybody. May the peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
The Israelites were on the opposing hill. with the valley between them. A giant, nearly 10 feet tall, stepped out from the Philistine line into the open, Goliath from Gath. He had a bronze helmet on his head and was dressed in armor 126 pounds thick. He wore bronze shin guards and carried a bronze sword. His spear was like a fence rail. The spear tip alone weighed over 15 pounds. His shield bearer walked ahead of him. Goliath stood there and called out to the Israelite troops, "Why bother using your whole army? Am I not Philistine enough for you? And you're all committed to Saul, aren't you? So pick your best fighter and pit him against me. If he gets the upper hand and kills me, the Philistines will all become your slaves. But if I get the upper hand and kill him, you'll all become our slaves and serve us. I challenge the troops of Israel this day. Give me a man. Let us fight it out together." Each morning and evening for 40 days, Goliath took his stand and made this speech.
Thanks, Dad.
We're good, I think, Sid. All right. Hey, everybody.
Hi.
Thanks for coming today. I appreciate you all. So we just heard what I'm sure many of you know, even if you weren't churched as a child or grew up in the church, you would have known about the story of David and Goliath. And you probably also would have known that it tends to be told from the underdog kind of take, which is David, who will eventually become King David and save the Israelites, goes up against this massive giant, and he uses a slingshot and he shoots a little pebble and hits him and then cuts off his head. That's the usual telling of this story as it is. And I mean, the trope of that story is also used everywhere. Like, that underdog story has been used throughout time. And this story was written 2,000 years ago. It's been used a lot. And this past couple weeks, I've been watching a lot of wrestling. and I don't mean like Olympic wrestling where they push each other out of a circle. I mean like WWF, Let's Get Ready to Rumble, body slamming, wrestling. And for some reason, I really wanted to talk about wrestling and how it relates to the Bible. I don't know why, I felt compelled. And as I was going down this wrestling rabbit hole, I started to watch biographies of the wrestlers. And it was so interesting to me that they have these storylines of these characters they play and the narratives of the stories that are told of the wrestlers are often so different from the lives of these men, and often their stories were tragic. Drug abuse, like they lived a hard-hitting life all for the glory of people cheering them on, and people really are into these stories. And when I was thinking about it, I was like, that's kind of like the Bible. I mean, it was written in a particular time, in a particular place, by a particular group of people. And there's two levels of it. There's what's written as a narrative, and then there's like the history and there's or the actual events that is written about. And those don't necessarily align. This piece that we read is written during around the time of the Babylonian exile. So the Israelites have been kicked out of Israel, or kicked out of Judah. They've been conquered. And it's written about a time that happened at least 500 years before that, that had kind of carried on as oral tradition. And imagine you're being conquered. Of course you would want to write a story about the greatest king of all time, the king that saved you. And you'd probably want to have a good origin story to really beef up the character of King David. So what we're hearing might not necessarily be the case. Like, what if the story was told by the Philistines and not the Israelites? It probably would have sounded a lot differently. And even like the height of Goliath is different. In some pieces that we have, it says that he was 6'9". Some pieces it said he was 9'9". And when I was reading the passage, it says that he has a shield bearer that walks in front of him. And I was thinking, well, what happens if he has to have a shield bearer walk in front of him? Because he can't really see that well. Because medically, the thing that causes gigantism tends to be these huge pituitary tumors that happen in the front of our head. And a lot of time it causes vision problems. So what happens if Goliath couldn't really see that well? And sometimes this gigantism happens when they're 16 years old. So what happens if he was like 16 or 17? And what happens if he didn't have a choice? He was just this big guy and they're like, you're the guy that's gonna go fight. It kind of changes the story of a little man underdog. And then I learned that the slingshot that's used isn't really what the slingshot is in modern day. And there's been articles written about it, about how like the rock can be equivalent when it's shot through the sling of the ancient slingshot was the power of a 44 caliber bullet. So it really changes that when you think about it's not just like this kid slingshot shooting like a pebble at a giant, if it's like a bullet that hits him in the head. And why talk about this at all? And I was thinking about what polarizes us. In modern day, the stories we tell often. And I find the more that I dig into a story or a narrative and the more I am unwilling to believe it not to be true, the more that I put the person on the other side of the story as the other and the othering. And the way that news is told and talked about is really, it's very siloed. It's very one side or the other. And there's a particular point of view being told. And what happens if we were open to the idea that there's another side of the story? That sometimes the stories that are told by the people with the most power. What happens if Goliath is a kid who can't see very well and is getting shot in the head by a man that's able-bodied? It kind of changes how I feel about the story. And it also could be equally as true, because as I said, the Bible's written by the Israelites. It was written for a particular purpose, because they were suffering in those moments where they were being taken over by the Babylonians. It's not to say that the Israelites didn't suffer. It's just also other people suffer too. And it's about holding space for that other side. And when I was watching these wrestlers, I came across this one, which I thought many people would know. Andre the Giant. He was, had the same, potentially the same pituitary tumor that Goliath had. And when I looked into his biography, he became gigantic, like over six foot around the age of 15. And by the time he was 17, he was closer to 7 feet. And he became a wrestler. And it says that the thing he would say is that he lived in a world that wasn't built for him. When he would travel, and he traveled 300 days a year as a wrestler, he would fly and he would need 2 seats, and he couldn't use the washroom the whole time of the flight because he didn't fit in. And he couldn't barely fit into a cab, and his friends used to have to hail cabs for him and kind of shove him in before the cab driver drive away, because they didn't want that much weight on the suspension of their cars. And he went through people looking at him and bullying and lots of different things. And that's more of the historical narrative of his life. But the narrative of his as a wrestler was he was unstoppable. He was like the eighth wonder of the world. He was this huge guy that was undefeated. And yet, at the same time, he was a guy that had severe chronic pain. And at the end of his wrestling, they would have to make sure he was close enough to the rope so he could pull himself back up, because he couldn't do it anymore. Because the thing with this condition is you just don't stop growing. And eventually, you outgrow your heart and organs. Everything just gets too big, and your body can't sustain itself anymore. And what happens if 2,000 years from now, someone finds the story of Andre the Giant as a wrestler, and they think that is historical? If they see him in the ring fighting, either as the good guy or the bad guy, because he played both, people might mistake that as truth. When there's another story that maybe wasn't told, that they didn't know about. And it just, I don't know why, but I find it comforting, also destabilizing. And I'm gonna have to say, like, in the beginning, trying to hold space for two truths has been very difficult for me, that two opposing things can be true at the same time. It takes a lot of patience and a lot of effort to do that. But I also think it's that kind of holding that kind of space that helps us not other people. And it's that holding that kind of space that helps go against the tide of the polarization and the stories and the narratives that we hear today. Holding that maybe the entire story isn't being told, that maybe there's another perspective you're not hearing, and maybe that perspective is also true. And the freedom in that. Because these myths, as they're told, are stories. But it could also be told a different way. And it can be looked at a different way. I think that's the interesting thing about myths. They're stories that always are and never were. They're not actually historical, but they talk a lot about humanity. So this David and Goliath story that we read, it can be looked at through different lenses. And that's the beauty of myth, is that you can take that mythological story and you can look at it from the perspective of David or the perspective of Goliath. And both of those are equal perspectives. Like, the Israelites were scared and also wanted to protect themselves. So were the Philistines. And it's the easy road is often to say, well, one's bad and one's good. That's the kind of the easiest path forward. But I think there's a different path. And I think that is kind of the beauty of kind of the Jesus way. Like just the things might not be what they seem. And if we can hold space for that and consider another perspective, that as humanity, that might serve us really well. And thank you again for all being here. I appreciate you all. That's good. I just wanted to thank Anthony for playing Bohemian Rhapsody for me today. I wanted a larger-than-life song to represent the larger-than-life characters that I was talking about. That's the first time he played. And that's the first time he's played it. So... And I want to thank you all for being here. And if it's okay, I know we have a little extra time. I just wanted to do a small prayer. So let us pray. God, by whatever name we call you and however we experience you in our everyday life, please hear our prayers. Help us to stay open to another perspective. Help us remember that being connected in community is how humans are often at their greatest. That polarization might be a good selling point, but it doesn't feel good. And I wanted to say a prayer for Jacqueline. And if she's watching, I want her to know that everyone at RUC sending their love as she heals from a recent heart attack. Jacqueline, we see you, we love you, and we hope to have you back soon. Thank you all for coming again. Amen. And now, go out into the world and stay open. And may the love of God and the power of Jesus Christ and, oh, what's the other thing? The power and communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon you now and forever. Amen. Go out. Thank you, Ronson.